like to open up our work session tonight at 7 o'clock regarding the Housing Partnership's request for an amendment to Section 10-1503 of the city's zoning ordinance relating to residential plan unit developments and request for an access easement for property located on Bedford Way. I'd like the work session to go from 7 till 7:30. And David, if you could get us going, please.
In a brief overview, this process started a number of months ago. It has two components. One is an amendment to the zoning ordinance that recognizes affordable housing, to put it generically, and another is a request to take a look at a particular area. We've been working with the Housing Partnership on a number of initiatives, and I'm pleased to say that we've probably come up with a draft that allows for a starting point. It's been worked on cooperatively with the Housing Partnership and also with the city's consultant, Tainter of Tainter Associates, and Rick Tainter's here to address the nuts and bolts. Well, what we're hoping is that we have the framework now for something that will help guide the discussion on the issues that are out there. There's still a number of them. And part of the intent, too, is to create something that is somewhat familiar to the board and ultimately, hopefully, to the council, in that it is based on some of the initiatives that the city has had in its zoning ordinance for some time. However, the wizard of the calculations is Rick Tainter, and pass it over to him, and I would invite the Housing Partnership, since this is a work session in regards to their referral, that they should participate as well. And we do have some extra copies of it if there's people in the public that might wish to see it. If you can recognize them, we'll try to get the copies out to them.
Okay, thank you. Rick,
thank you. Okay, thank you. Let me just pass this out. We made some kind of relatively technical and minor changes to the draft that you have already seen, and it won't be a huge surprise once you pass those down that way. Once we get all the copies around, I'll see how many extra copies we have. We can pass those out. I also have kind of a cheat sheet here to talk about.
This is for me.
To talk about the calculations and let me also.
I got it.
I can hand those out too. I'll just begin by giving the overview of how we got to this place. See, do we have enough copies of the draft ordinance at this time?
Peter, if you could collect the extras.
Why don't you take these?
Yes, okay. Anyone on the public one?
The initial approach that was proposed by the Housing Partnership was to modify the existing residential PUD district, which is meant to be an open space preservation tool, a way to provide more flexibility and also to provide a significant amount of open space preservation as part of that. And we looked at that, and we looked at some of the, you know, the kind of problems with trying to squeeze something in a general residence type district and try to squeeze, you know, adapt that to that model, and it didn't seem to be working to us very well. And so we took another approach at it, which was to create a new PUD that, instead of being focused on open space, was focused on affordable housing. And it had, I think as you recall, there was an issue, or the strategy or the approach was to trade off higher density for a public benefit, that public benefit being affordable housing, but it wasn't as clearly defined, the quid pro quo in that regard. And so we've tried to define that more precisely here. And as David said, this is a starting point. And obviously, the numbers and the calculations are all subject to further discussion. But let me just go through the ordinance, and I'll talk about some of the changes that we've made in the last 24 hours. We begin with a purpose and intent statement, which specifically says the purpose of this ordinance is to facilitate the creation of affordable housing options and authorizes the planning board to grant a conditional use permit for an increase in development intensity based on the provision of affordable units. And it's adopted as an innovative land use control in accordance with state law. Item C1 says, in any residential district in which dwellings with two or more units are otherwise permitted, the planning board may do this. And that would essentially would be the general residence districts and the apartment district. I guess that would basically be it. I mean, theoretically, the business.
Garden apartment, mobile home might be another.
Right. There are other districts, but primarily it would be the general residence districts where it would apply, where any impact would come.
Let me also just add one other point. If this is a good experiment, it is with this section too that you can extend it to other parts of the city. But the PUD itself is limited to these districts, so it's a similar model.
The lot area, in order to be eligible to apply, you have to have an area at least three times the minimum lot area required for the zoning district. Item E says that in one of these residential density incentive PUDs, you can have all the uses permitted in a residential PUD. And one of the questions that we've talked about is, should those permitted uses include daycare and home occupation too? Those are uses that, well, those are uses that are allowed in PUDs, in residential PUDs, and the issue is, with this higher density, will that create a congestion problem? So it's a policy question that needs to be discussed. Turning to page two, there are two options for figuring out how many units are currently allowed on the site or might be allowed by this ordinance or in the absence of applying this ordinance. Number two is the one that you're familiar with, the number of lots that could be developed through a conventional subdivision plan. Number one is sort of an alternative that is provided to the applicant if the applicant doesn't want to go through the expense of creating essentially a second subdivision plan, a conventional subdivision plan. And it's a numerical calculation. It will give a lower density than going through a subdivision plan. And the reason for that is that it excludes from the developable areas that you could normally include in your subdivision area, like slopes over 15%, 100-year floodplains, and so forth. So basically, number one is for the ease and the convenience of the developer, but would result in a lower density. So it's that kind of trade-off.
Rick?
Yes.
Should we wait till the end for questions, or?
It would be fine with me if we want to take them as we go along.
I think we'll probably have enough time if we want to take them while we're going along.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead, Don.
If you have a question, bring it up.
Yeah, I do. The terminology, for the purpose of this computation, the developable area shall be the total parcel area excluding all open water bodies, inland and tidal wetlands subject to this ordinance. Why not the buffer zones? That implies that the buffer zones are part of the calculation.
Mm-hmm. Well, I guess my approach was
they're not part of the calculation.
The buffers.
They are part of
the calculation. The buffers would be under this.
Where does it say that?
It doesn't say it. It just says.
It didn't exclude them.
It didn't exclude them.
It only excluded open water bodies, inland and tidal wetlands,
excluding,
but not wetlands.
Oh, that which is excluded.
Yes.
Which, by the way, is the same process that we use today in a PUD to help on the bonus.
All right, I got it. Thank you.
I have a
yes.
I have a question. Yeah. It'd be nice, I think, that if we cited some examples, like say there's a lot in a general residence zone. Pick a size, and then give the example. How many units?
It's coming.
Page two. It's under your page there. we'll get a little bit further. No, it's actually the second page. It's on the table there in front of you.
Yeah.
And I was about to get into that. So item G is the place where we get into some computational difficulties. But basically what it does is essentially based on the level of subsidy or the level of affordability, it provides bonus units, or a fraction or more than a fraction of bonus units for every affordable dwelling unit provided. And there are two multipliers. One is if the units are permanently restricted and affordable to households that are below 120% of the area median income, which is being discussed as workforce housing, then you get 3/4 of a bonus unit for each affordable unit. Each such affordable unit provided. And if it's even further subsidized down to 80% of the median income, then you get 1 1/4 bonus units per affordable unit. And it goes to a maximum density bonus of 50% above your base residential density. And that's why I handed out this second page here with a table on it, just to go through this as a hypothetical example so that we can understand what we're talking about here. So in this case, we've got a hypothetical case, a hypothetical site where the base density is 20 units. So somebody with a conventional subdivision plan could come in and put in 20 dwelling units, 10 duplexes or whatever it is. And the table below shows the various ways that you could get to your maximum density bonus. You could do it with eight affordable units, eight units that are below 120% of median income, or with 13 work, I'm sorry, eight affordable units, yeah, but below 100, did I have that backwards? Yeah, eight affordable units that are below 80% of median income, or 13 units that are below 120% of median income, or some mix in between. So you can see that depending on how you mix it, it would be either between 8 or 13 units that would get you your additional 10 unit bonus. And this is the, you know, this is the most complicated part of the ordinance, so I'm certainly willing to take lots of questions here, if you have any.
So the maximum number would be 50% of the 20,
yes,
which gives you your 30.
Exactly.
And then depending on the way you provide it, you can calculate up to that number.
Isn't, I do have a question. Isn't there fear that if you have a vast minority of units that are affordable, it could be used by developers as some sort of shoehorn to make a couple of affordable units once they get their approval for the PUD and then find some way around it? That's just my fear as we advance the ordinance. It's not something that has to be dealt
sure.
with tonight, yep. but I would think that if they want to seriously approach this ordinance as a means of development, any future developer understand that you got to have some minimum number of affordable units to really take this seriously if you're going through these density requirements.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Just a question on whether this is you're basing this on what you have seen in other areas, what's typical, space calculations. I mean, how did you, what are the rules of thumb that you use to kind of get to go from 20 to 30 as maximum, or to think about those two thresholds for
right.
bonuses?
Right. Well, I have to admit that, you know, to a certain extent, it came out of the discussions about this particular project we've been talking about and thinking about, you know, what might be their underlying base density, trying to estimate what that might be based on the information that was provided to us at previous mm-hmm. meetings, and, you know, knowing where they're trying to get to. So, I mean, partly it's that,
okay.
getting to that. I think that, you know, we will probably hear from them later this evening as to whether these numbers, to what extent these numbers are feasible for them. They are certainly different than their numbers, because they are talking about 100% of their units falling within either the workforce or the affordable category, where we're only saying you only need to have 43% or 27% or 43%, depending on your mix. With a 50-50 mix, we would be talking about a third of their units being subsidized in some way, and they're talking about 100%. So we're not talking about the same project. I was trying to design this to be something that might be possible for a private developer to take on, not just a nonprofit.
Mm-hmm.
And so I didn't want to focus on a nonprofit. Mm-hmm. I wanted to make it a little bit more feasible for a private developer.
Thank you. That was one of my concerns, mm-hmm. that I was thinking that to some degree we might be building an ordinance based on a proposal as opposed to building
mm-hmm.
an ordinance
exactly.
based on the need for affordable housing,
yeah.
something that could be, you know, handed off to any developer that wants to come through and say, we want to build something, but it's easier for us to build affordable housing based on your regulations.
And having said that, I think that it's, in my experience, I've seen a lot of this type of ordinance that gives a density bonus for providing affordable units, but they don't give this level of bonus, and because of that, they're not used, because they don't provide enough of an incentive for a private developer. So you see a lot of ordinances that say for every one unit you provide, you get a 10% increase in density and that kind of thing, and it doesn't seem to work. So it's important to look at, try to make it work.
Rick, has this draft that we have before us germinated from previous experience, or
it is
your thoughts behind it, I
yeah,
guess?
It's, well, I would say that the structure of the draft is based on your residential PUD ordinance right
Correct.
Now. So take that as the base. Then I would say it's a combination of three things. One is the structure of the ordinance you're based. The other is what the kind of rough numbers that came out of the housing partnership's proposal. And the third is looking at other ordinances that I've seen that haven't worked and wanting to make
mm-hmm.
this work.
Okay. All right, great. Thank you.
Are there any questions on the numbers before we move on to the next section? Okay. Turning to page 3, item H, design requirements. One of the things that we talked about was, and I think this is important, and you see successful affordable housing developments do this, looking at making sure that those people who are low income are not stigmatized by being in a unit that is obviously of a lower quality than, or lower design quality even, than the market rate units. So we wrote into this that affordable units should be dispersed throughout the development, and that the exterior design of units within the development should be comparable to, and to the extent possible, indistinguishable from market rate, you know, low income versus market rate, or affordable versus market rate. So that is, I think, an important social equity goal to look at, is to make sure that when we're doing this kind of development, that we're not just creating an enclave for lower income people and another place for market rate, for those who can afford to pay market rate. And so there's a certain amount of cross subsidy involved in the development in that type of issue. The addition that was made was made at the suggestion of the planning staff, is that that issue of exterior elevation should be subject to the review and approval by the planning board as part of the conditional use permit process, just to specify that.
Rick, going back to item three.
Yep.
The exterior design of the units within the development should be comparable, and to the extent possible, indistinguishable. Mm-hmm. To what? To whom?
Indistinguishable among each other, regardless of their restriction, right, of the affordability restriction. So essentially, you look at a unit and you can't tell whether it's an affordable unit, a workforce unit, or a market rate.
Within that development,
yes.
Not to anything abutting it.
Within that development.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm.
And one of the, I should emphasize this, the exterior design of units, because one thing that I could envision happening, and it would really be subject to the, you know, be a policy issue for the board to consider on a case-by-case basis, but, and this does happen in other communities that have this kind of regulation, is that the interior of the unit is not comparable. You know, you don't do as much finish, or you leave spaces unfinished, or whatever. The important thing is that from a, you know, an external point of view, that you're not stigmatizing people. Mm-hmm. So, or you could even have, and this does happen, I think, in some developments, you'll see two townhouse units side by side. Only one of them is a townhouse unit, that's market rate, and the other one is an up and down two family. Mm-hmm. It's affordable. And that's,
we see that in the Heights anyway, where you have one duplex unit is just basically original everything.
Yeah.
And the other duplex unit is open concept and has granite, you know,
right.
Granite,
right.
You know, cabinet trees, yeah. And all of this. And you're just talking about the exterior.
Like about the exterior, right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're not trying to do social engineering here, mm-hmm. Just trying to, you know, trying to do, make sure that we're not stigmatizing. Mm-hmm.
I think provision two could potentially be confusing, especially given that, like in this case, we are talking about affordable instead of a mix. I mean, I assume that's there to apply in other cases for the same purposes, but.
Yes, I understand what you're saying. Okay, good point. To a true mix of all levels of
it
whatever.
It could be confusing,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah. That's part of my concern as I was reading this ordinance, and maybe something in the ordinance to reflect more along the lines of what you're saying here. That there are much more possibilities than just one or the other.
Yeah.
That there could be many levels. And in most affordable housing situations, that is the case. There's two or three or four levels until someone graduates to market value housing.
Got it. In item I-1, the rationale behind this was, the original wording was that because you're looking at increased density, and because this, in particular the side yard setbacks in the ordinance are relatively small, that there should be an increase in the side yards, perimeter side yards, not within the development, but around the perimeter of the development, if in response to that density. We looked at this a little bit more and thought that perhaps rear yards was not an issue, because rear yards are already in the GRA and GRB, they're already 20 and 25 feet. So maybe that's not so much of an issue, because we're not really changing the height of buildings, we're just changing kind of the concentration of buildings. So suggestion here is to delete the words "and rear." Then once having done that, then that opens it up to an even simpler wording, which is, instead of going through this kind of confusing formula, just say around the perimeter of the site, on the side yards, you should have 20, no less than 20 feet. That would be kind of another option, something to think about as we go through this process. Item two, the minimum yards internal to the PUD are listed. I know that the, we'll hear from the Housing Partnership that they have some concerns about the 30-foot front yard issue, we can understand that. When you're trying to create increased density, maybe you don't need to have the substantial front yards that are typical for a conventional subdivision. So that'd be something to consider also. Then number three, the planning board shall establish such requirements for open space as it determines to be necessary in the best interest in the city. Again, this is not an open space PUD. It doesn't have a fixed 25% open space requirement, but there may be issues you may want to look at as you're doing site plan review, look at play areas and buffer areas and that kind of thing. So that leaves it open for you to look at that type of thing. Item J, 1 and 2, there's no substantive change here. It's just a simplification of the language. As we're going through the zoning ordinance revision project, we're trying to simplify all the cross-references and so forth in the ordinance. So this is just to make that wording somewhat clearer and less verbose. And item J3 is to specify that if a road is going to become a public road, that it has to meet city standards at the time of acceptance. Did you want to say anything about that, David?
No, that's generally the way we've handled it on all PUDs, and frankly, there hasn't been any upgrade. But part of the idea of the PUD is you got the bonus because you were going to do something that wasn't to city standards. So if you're going to ask the city to take it over, then it should come up to city standards.
Item K, the review and approval procedures are taken pretty much from the residential PUD requirements. The planning board findings and actions in item L are pretty much taken from the assisted living PUD requirements. The issue that planning staff raised with me was, do we need to have more specific criteria in item LD in terms of adverse impacts? There really aren't in the area that we've drawn it from. And I guess that'd be something we'd want to discuss as we go along. We don't need to decide that, obviously, at this point, but that's a question that comes up. The actions, again, based on the residential PUD and the reservation of the right to deny, is also based on the residential PUD. It basically says that the planning board can grant the permit for the maximum number of allowable units. It can grant the permit for less than the maximum number of allowable units. It can deny the permit. And nothing in this ordinance shall be presumed to imply that the planning board has to grant the conditional use permit. It's just an option if it's in the city's best interest. Under item M, this planning board can attach conditions. Item N, the planning board adopts rules and regulations to implement it. And then there are definitions added of what an affordable unit is, what area median family income is, the base residential density, and the residential density incentive. And because we changed some of the wording and made it a little bit simpler, we were able to delete that proposed definition for yield plan. So that is, again, made it a little bit simpler.
Was that the end of the?
That's the end.
Okay. May we revisit for just a moment F1. I've read this 10 times, and I still do not see, and perhaps I'm just being dense, but I do not see where the buffer zone is in fact.
I know what you're questioning. Yeah. Okay. So it was the word inclusion versus exclusion. I think we were talking across purposes, and I know where your confusion is. We're saying, take the total lot area.
Right.
Take out wetlands, water bodies, slopes over 15%, and areas subject to valid open space restrictions. That becomes your developable area. We're still including the buffer area in what's called the developable area. Now, the reason for that is...
So you are, in fact,
we are including it. We are not excluding it. Right.
Okay.
So I know that's where the confusion was. The reason for that is that if you were to do a normal conventional subdivision plan, you would actually be including all of those areas in your total land use area. you wouldn't be able to develop them, but you'd be able to include them in, or some of those areas, you'd be able to include in your minimum lot size, for example.
Well, they could develop it by seeking a conditional use permit.
But even if they didn't want to develop it, they would be able to include it in the developable area. This is not saying this they can develop it. This is, we're trying to compute here how many units they can get out of it. So what we're saying is, we're actually being stricter than you would be mm-hmm. if you were in a conventional subdivision plan, because if you can imagine that, you know, say that if looking at a conventional subdivision plan and looking at the if there were a section of it that were buffer areas, mm-hmm. so we're not even wetlands, so it's just buffer areas, you'd be able to draw your lot lines to include those and to include those in your minimum mm-hmm. lot area. You wouldn't be able to develop them.
Right.
And so that's what we're saying here. We're saying you can still include those. Right, you can't include steep slopes, and you can't include, and we can, I don't have a strong feeling about this one way or the other. I was just thinking that might take it, yeah. to make it even more restrictive, to make it more difficult to do this. And
so what you're saying is that this really is relative only to computing the residential density.
The base density, yes.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Rick, could I go to, and I know it's a play on words here, but H4
sure.
says all exterior elevations shall be blah. Mm-hmm. Should that be building elevations?
Sure.
I mean, you could have
an
elevation of.
Yeah, it wouldn't be the land. The you're right. I know.
Well, again, it's a play on words, but.
Sure. No, I understand. So.
Yeah, I think we might want to get the partnership in.
Yep.
But before,
yeah, we get.
Before you do, though, I think it would be helpful if Rick perhaps explained a little more K4, because that's really getting to the nuts and bolts of how we ensure that the proposed project complies.
Yeah, that actually comes to Ray's point earlier.
Right.
So the K4 basically talks about how you restrict long-term affordability. And preliminary approval by the planning board is subject to site plan review and to review as to content and form by the city's legal department of any restrictive covenants, cooperative agreements, or similar instruments requiring the participation of the city. As appropriate to verify compliance with this section, the legal department may review appropriate condominium and cooperative agreements that are enacted as part of a project. This would also include the this would be part of the covenant. The restrictive covenants would be those things that we're talking about of how you promote that long-term affordability, so you don't use that as a wedge to get a development in mm-hmm. and then don't have the affordable units later on. And we were talking, the partnership last time around, I believe, gave some samples of some covenants or restrictions from other locations. But this specifically says the planning board has the ability, the legal department has the ability to review those and certify that they're adequate to protect the city's interest.
Aren't there any minimum standards or guidelines that could be placed in the ordinance? Because by doing this, legal departments may change. I mean, 30 years down the line, of course. But
Bob will still be here.
Yeah, more than likely. But the issue, though, is the issue still remains that my fear is that with individual applications coming forward with an RDI PUD, the rules may not be the same for everybody, probably because the circumstances aren't the same. Mm-hmm. But if everybody's coming forward with the same idea of what to expect, and it's in the ordinance, it's easier for that developer to understand what they're in for, rather than saying that the legal department would review any covenants. Having some guidelines as to what covenants the city of Portsmouth prefers in this PUD.
Well, actually, if you go to the next page under L1C, we should have gone to that before you. It talks. It doesn't get down to the specifics of the covenants, but it says that they have to address rental costs or sale and resale prices and occupancy restrictions, and they have to be for the longest legally binding term and have to be recorded at final approval. I mean, that takes it a little bit further. I hesitate to get more specific than that.
And I agree.
Yeah.
Trying to get some sort of foundation from which the developer understands where we're coming from, and then they build on that specific to their project. That's all I'm going to
do. Okay.
If we don't have any questions, if the housing partnership has a couple quick questions or comments or...
Yes, thank you. First of all, and I'll turn this over to Brian Diane, who can address the numbers issue much better than I, but first of all, we appreciate the efforts on the part of the city staff to come up with a city proposal. We've indicated to the board that we conceptually endorse this. And we have done our own analysis of the numbers to determine whether or not this proposed language is going to work for our project and conceivably for other affordable housing projects which the housing partnership might want to become involved in. At the end of the day, the numbers as computed under this ordinance do seem to work. However, there are two problems which will need to be addressed as part of this discussion. The first is that the ordinance language as drafted does seem to require that there be restriction on the number of dwelling units within a building and the number of buildings that can be on a lot. I've had some I was able to take a look at the very quickly at some of the revisions in today's ordinance and note that there's some language in the conditions of approval section which may assist in our discussion about that. But this is a problem for us because in order to and I think for other affordable housing projects too, because in order to really deal with the reality of construction costs, price points, market issues, that kind of thing, in order to be able to have us do an affordable housing project, we need to be able to have more than four dwellings in a building, which currently is what is permitted under the GRB and which it, what is allowed under the terms of this ordinance. So what we would be looking to do is to have some flexibility incorporated into this language to allow greater than four dwelling units per building, consistent with what we presented to you in the conceptual plan at the last time that we were here. Similarly, we'd like some flexibility in terms of the number of buildings on the lot for two reasons. One is that it is a factor in terms of cost, in terms of the reality of being able to construct this and market this in a fashion which is going to cover our overhead. And secondly, we think that by allowing flexibility in terms of the number of dwelling units in a building and the number of buildings on a lot, we can really, that works nicely with the city's objective of trying to really maintain as much open space here as is possible. The second problem that we see with the ordinance as drafted in terms of our particular project, both this and others, is that the requirement for the front yard internal setback of 30 feet. As the board may recall, when we made our amendment proposal several months ago, we requested that the front yard setback from the principal access way be 20 feet. We ask that the board incorporate some language in this ordinance to allow some flexibility on that front, and if it's going to provide the board with some comfort level, we think what may happen or what might work is to indicate that it would be no less than 20 feet from the principal access way. And again, the reason for that concern is driven by costs. The need to be able to keep the project as compacted as possible. And in this instance, we also want to, you know, again, preserve as much open space around the perimeters, which I know is a concern which is reflected in this ordinance. So at the end of the day, and I'll turn this over to Brian and Diane in case they have anything else to add, we are supportive of, in general terms, of this ordinance. However, we do think that there are two issues that need to be worked out to enable us to be able to say with assurance that the numbers are going to work here. And those two issues are the number of dwelling units in a building and the number of buildings on the lot. And then secondly, the distance on the internal yard requirements from front yard requirements from the principal access way.
Could I ask a quick question?
Absolutely.
Could you point me to the issues? I see I understand the four unit issue for the GRB, but since this ordinance refers to the residential PUD district and the residential PUD district allows attached townhouses or other configurations, wouldn't that give you the flexibility, or you don't think that does?
I don't think it does, because okay. If you look at the GRB permitted uses, and you have a reference here in your ordinance tying what we can do to the permitted uses in the GRB, it does reference buildings per lot. And I think that's where the problem is going to arise. And not even necessarily for this project, but for other potential projects down the road.
Okay.
B2.
Yes, I understand that. So maybe there's a conflict there, because would you, if the last phrase of C2 were eliminated, see, would then the reference to the residential PUD be fine, because I think that the residential PUD reference refers to attached townhouses and other configurations. I guess that's, I'm trying to get at what will solve this.
Yeah, I think, and maybe in the interest of time, maybe we can take this up on another occasion, but I think that what needs to be looked at is the actual permitted uses under Table 2. And if you go to, again...
No, don't go to Table 2, because if we take out that last phrase in...
That'll break that tie that you were talking
about. That'll break that tie.
Yeah.
Well...
We can talk about, I guess it's something we should talk about.
I agree. We're running late on time here.
And I do want to ask, it's just an informational question about the number of buildings per lot. What is the connection? I just want to make sure, see where I'm causing problems when I write this. So what is the particular phrase that's causing a problem here?
Well, the notion is that the number three there indicates that it has to comply with all zoning and so forth regulations other than those waived or modified here under. And I believe that potentially one then has to go back to the GRB permitted uses under Table 2 in the existing ordinance. And that does talk about number of buildings per lot. So again, in order to make sure that there's no issue and no confusion on a going forward basis, I think we need to address that now to ensure that we're comfortable that the numbers are going to work.
Yes, I just want to say that
briefly,
was not the intent.
Right, and then, David, I think staff ought to continue to work on this. Maybe if we can take input, and then...
You know, what would be the desire of the board, actually, for the next step? If you think this is a reasonable alternative, do you want us to keep working on it? And I assume you're going to say yes there. But the other issue is, do you want us to work on it and bring this to, for example, the public hearing in September? Or ultimately, we need to make a report back.
I'd feel more comfortable with just bringing it back so we can review it again before we have a public hearing on it, just because it seems like there are a lot of different issues that have been raised tonight specific to making this an ordinance that works for the city as a whole as opposed to this particular proposal that I'd like to see and make sure that it works. And I think that that can be done with another review of the language and such.
We had another half-hour work session, David. That would be my, that's what
yeah,
I'd like to see.
Would,
one more
would,
work session, then we can...
Certainly.
Have staff continue to work on it.
Should we schedule to really move this along then, an hour work session for the next meeting?
Yes.
Yeah.
Get it out to
everybody. I'd like to do that, and that way there we can move on with the public.
You may want to ask the Housing Partnership if that messes up any of their plans.
I'll defer to Brian Wyatt on that question.
Well, I'm not quite sure as to, I'm Executive Director of the Housing Partnership, and I'm not quite sure then what is the schedule for review of our proposal as a project. We have another work session that's about the ordinance.
Your project really can't move forward without the ordinance.
Right.
So they're integrally mixed.
We need
right.
that as a structure within which
right.
to build the actual proposal.
Right. I understand.
I'd rather take more time on getting this ordinance correct so that we're all comfortable.
Yes.
And as things progress from there, that's fine. But
I think that what we're looking at as a practical matter is to, given this desire for another work session, is that a public hearing would be scheduled on this most likely in the October session. Is that correct?
That would be correct, yes.
If the board desires it,
yes.
I would recommend it.
That would be my
because
recommendation.
That makes sense. We have a work session next month and the month after
correct.
We do the
yeah.
public hearing.
Is that,
so then I guess the question for you is how does that
next
impact
month's meeting and
if you feel able to answer that at this
and
point.
And there's a city council three readings.
The city council piece of this would come after the planning board.
Correct, after our recommendation.
Okay.
But they would have two meetings per month, so you might see two readings in a single month and then the third reading.
I wouldn't okay. make predictions.
It's probably wise,
yes.
David.
With that being
well,
said,
very wise.
Unfortunately, I do need to sort of predict because I need to have some sense as to the
and
property owner, Sean Mahoney, and others who are interested in the project moving forward, obviously. But I also understand that this is a citywide zoning ordinance for which you hope to have a comfortable feeling about it on all sites across the city.
And I think that's the board's feeling now, is we need to tailor make this for every available lot in the city, not just site-specific.
Absolutely.
That makes sense. And I do want to say that, you know, I appreciate Rick's comments about how these ordinances have been designed in cities since towns all over states around the country, and you find that if you don't really have an adequate enough density bonus, you're not going to have it utilized.
Correct.
And I can say that us running the numbers that we can make this work.
Good, thank you.
Thank you. Would it make sense to, George had a good point, to schedule the public hearing for a 1 hour prior to next month's meeting, and then the work session, and then the public hearing directly after that? That's going to assume that we have 1 hour to tidy up anything that we need. Does that make sense to you guys?
It's difficult to really present a finished.
I'd prefer that we do the work session next month and then in October.
I like to chew on it at home before we actually come here.
I would add, though, there is no requirement for this board to hold a public hearing because ultimately it is the council. Mm-hmm. However, if you want to get all the formal input before you make your recommendation, that is the best way of doing it.
Absolutely.
That's what I prefer.
But I am conscious of the problems that they have with their schedules, and that's part of the rub of the two issues that this thing addresses. One is a site and one is a process.
Correct.
So could I ask, go ahead.
Well, in the spirit of sort of moving things along then, since a lot of explanation was given to us tonight, it would seem that if we as individuals have things that we would like input on, or for example, I'd like to think about the daycare provision that you raised, that we want to get that to you ahead of time and not wait until the work session, because otherwise we're delaying it even further. So it seems like it's kind of incumbent upon all of us to take a look at what's here and raise other questions that might come up or other suggestions so that you can be prepared to respond to us.
Perhaps if you get the materials to us, we can give you everyone a list of what the things are that we expect to be discussing and also what we've discussed with the Housing Partnership.
We could just email the department at some point, just letting them know what our concerns are.
But you know the master list.
Okay.
Correct.
I was just going to add that obviously the Housing Partnership will make itself available to work with the city staff on doing revisions, and maybe what we can do is to circulate some additional working drafts prior to the next work session so you'll have a much better handle when we actually get at the work session.
Okay. Fair enough. So thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.
2 minute break and we'll get the mics in order.
Yes. all day.
It's great. We can use our point.
Good evening. I'd like to welcome everybody to tonight's regular meeting for the Planning Board for August 17th. I'd like to start off the agenda with the approval of the minutes. If we could approve the minutes for both May 18th and July 20th.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. Any questions, any edits? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Moving on to item two, public hearings. The application of the State of New Hampshire owner and the State of New Hampshire Liquor Commission applicant for property located at 605 Route 1 Bypass, wherein site review approval is requested to construct a 25-foot, 6-inch by 44-foot, one-story addition to be used for public restrooms, a mechanical room, and a storage room with related paving, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said property is shown on Assessor Plan 235 as Lot 1 and lies within a general business district. Who's here tonight on behalf of the applicant?
Gordon Graham from the Bureau of Public Works, State of New Hampshire. Is the basically here to answer questions.
Do you have, can you just present us the project, what you're proposing as far as proposed improvements, utility improvements, site improvements, lighting, landscaping?
This is the project architect down yet.
Can you speak into the mic? We've got a lot of people who would like to see you and know who you are. And
yeah, we'll let the project architect do that and explain the project.
Good evening. My name is Alan Yaton. I'm an architect from Manchester. Born and brought up in this community, so some of you may know me from the past. What we propose to do here is we were presented with a project to provide public restrooms at the State Liquor Store at the Traffic Circle where none exist now, is to alleviate a tremendous problem that occurs, especially during the summer months and many people on vacation. This is the one stop they make heading north, south, and through town. So based upon the response, the state has put out a project whereby Hong Environmental from Portsmouth is the general contractor in a design build proposal to provide the bathroom facilities here and also at these liquor store in Salem, New Hampshire. But here we propose to add an addition partway under the existing canopy on what I will call the east side of the building facing Woodbury Avenue. It's close to the utilities that exist there for water, sewer, and electrical. And we intend on connecting into the existing systems either outside the building for water or inside the building for electrical and other needs. It's a one-story addition. It's sited similar to the warehouse addition that was constructed a number of years ago. And it'll have a roof approximately the same height or slightly lower than the existing store that's there. It'll have a shingle roof, and it'll be sited with clapboard siding, vinyl, similar to the warehouse. Access to the public restrooms will be limited through a single door. There'll be has both a large men's and women's room, equivalent to probably handling 300 or 400 people based upon the current plumbing codes. We feel it's adequate size in terms of meeting the demand that's there. We do have some exterior protection on the building in terms of bollards for traffic purposes. We are not eliminating any handicap parking or any of those kind of issues on site. There will be some indirect lighting on the structure to provide security and night lighting during the evening hours when the store is open and the darker periods during the winter months. There will be no access except a secured access from the interior of the store to this location. The current restrooms will be used and renovated for employee purposes. And in this same project, we're also improving some of the HVAC within the building and a couple other minor projects in terms of air curtains to improve energy efficiency in the total facility. And I'll answer any specific questions. We're not adding site lighting, i.e. poles and overhead lights. We are not adding nor we propose to add any landscaping, although we have proposed to reduce the density of some of the landscaping along the north side of the site as it abuts 95 to eliminate any, I want to call, people hanging around. And that addressed one of the situations I hope that was brought up at one of my early meetings with Mr. Holden and Lucy Tillman.
Before I ask questions of the board, could you just address the 12 items that were stipulated from, I believe, TAC, as far as comments that were to be added to the plans?
I would like to address those, but I don't have those 12 in front of me at the moment. Number one, the fence be added to the site plans to run along the rear of the property with a detail. As you well know, there already is a fence on the north side. There's none on the Woodbury Avenue side, but the division between this property and the state right-of-way is fenced at the, as we speak. That additional lighting be added to the site plan is aimed at the new facility. Currently, there are lights within the parking lot that are certainly adequate for that purpose. We've added exterior lighting to denote the entrances to the building and exits to the building. We feel that's adequate without overpowering, and we feel that what we propose is what's necessary for the project.
Did you add additional lighting to the site plan as TAC asked for?
No, we did not.
Okay.
If I could just ask on item one, that a fence be added to run along the rear of the property with a detail. Is there a fence detail on these drawings?
No, sir, there's not. The fence already exists along that property line.
I think there was an understanding that the height of the fence would be increased. That's why the detail is to be there.
It doesn't say that there's anything here in terms of the TAC review that we're adding the height to the fence.
I think if you look at number 12, that there was a meeting with various city officials and we discussed this and the fence was going to be added to. But then again, Deputy Chief Len DeSesso will be probably addressing us at some point.
Okay. That the hours of operation be added to the site plan. As an architect, we don't have anything to do with the hours of operation.
So you didn't add them to the site plan?
No, sir. That the responsibility for maintaining and securing the building belongs to someone other than the city and notes should be added to the site plans.
Was that done?
No, sir. That the water shutoff must be installed at least 5 feet away from the building, and that has been done.
Can you indicate it on the site plan, please?
There is a shutoff outside the building, just to the outside of the addition as proposed. That it will be added to the site plan that all water shall go through the existing water meter for the new bathrooms. I believe that's been added to the plans.
Can you confirm it?
Yes, I can. I've seen that note on the plans.
So that's a yes?
Yes. That the footings and foundations that go over the water main shall be bridged. That has been added. There's been a special grade beam installed as it crosses the water line. That the current sprinkler system in the existing facility shall be extended into the new bathroom facility, and that is being done.
Is it shown on the site plan?
Not on the site plan, it's on the building plans. That the rear emergency exit be labeled on the site plans as being locked at all times, that note has been added. That the handicap level shall be noted on the site plans for the handicap toilet and sink, that detail has been added to the plans. That a written agreement regarding the concerns of the city shall be prepared for review and approval by Deputy Police Chief DeSessa And I don't know anything about that particular concern. I would assume the state can address that. And then a meeting shall be held with the applicant and other parties to finalize the stipulations prior to the planning board meeting. I believe that was held, and I believe Mr. Melinchuk went to that meeting.
Mr. Chair, if I might ask.
Yes, Mr. Wall.
If I might ask a question.
Please.
You mentioned on stipulations 1, 2, 3, and 4 that you'd not added them to the plan. Do you mind if I ask why? I mean, individually, I mean, one at a time. The fence added to site plans run along the rear of the property as far as an agreement with the height. Has that not been come through? Certainly. Certainly.
If we could just get your name, please, for the record.
Gordon Graham from the Bureau of Public Works. The first meeting was where they asked for additional fencing. We had a second meeting, and there's a letter addressed from me to, I believe, David Holden or the planning board, addressing these 12 items. So I don't know whether you have a copy of that, but when we went out to look at the fence, we found that it was a 6-foot fence, and it's quite substantial, and it's all covered by brush on the other side of the fence along the right-of-way or the exit ramp for DOT. So I'm not sure. I don't think we agreed to increase the height of the fence. We addressed that in that letter.
But my question, is there a reason for that? Is it cost? Is it you didn't want to tear apart the brush?
Cost is one of them.
Okay.
The money was approved by the legislature to put these bathrooms there, not to improve the site necessarily, but if we have the money to do so,
I believe some of the concerns that we had, though, was that there may be homeless people in the area that may be able to, if they get off a bus or if assuming they're not homeless, but people could leave and hop the fence, in other words, that we were increasing the ability of people to use the facility, whether they're planning to go to the liquor store or not, that it becomes a public restroom, in other words, in the middle of the traffic circle. I can understand your concern about costs.
Well, the fence separates the property from the ramp. It's the ramp off the exit, the interstate.
Perhaps this may be a better question for our local police officer, local deputy chief, about if there's a problem with access to and from the site with that particular fence.
Yeah, because I think he was going to look at it.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Deputy Chief Len DeSessa. When we initially raised concerns about the fencing, I was more concerned with the sight line because of the shrubbery, the dense shrubbery around that. And I also had some concerns that fence was in good repair, a state of good repair. I'm comfortable with a 6-foot fence as long as it is continuous and as long as there is a good sight line beyond that fence. My concern was New Franklin School and the neighborhoods to the north of that fence. I've been assured by the planners here that there are going to be no signage on any of the highways saying public restroom, public stop. In that regard, I'm comfortable with the fence height as it is, as long as the shrubbery and the sight line is kept clear. I don't really see that as a bone of contention from the PD side at this point.
And just to continue on, my original question was about those first four stipulations. The second was, and since I still have you here, Len.
Sure.
Additional lighting be added to the site plan and that is aimed at the new facility. What were the bones of contention there, if any, as far as additional lighting or?
I'm of the opinion that more light is better than less light, and my notes, lighting was an issue, and I had a feeling and a sense when I left that meeting that there would be additional light thrown on the building and on the area. I don't think we discussed putting poles up, but I do remember there was additional lighting, and I would press for that.
Okay. And one last thing. I'm less concerned about the hours of operation for safety purposes than I am that number four, that the responsibility for maintaining and securing the building belongs to someone other than the city, and a note shall be added to the site plans. That seems like basically liability jargon for the legal department. But my bigger concern is, from a police standpoint, are there regular patrols that come through from the state police? Do they have similar
cruisers that go in one particular area, and how do they coordinate their efforts with local police?
We have joint jurisdiction at the Circle. We already have a memo of understanding with state. We cover accidents at the Circle. We enforce all regulations and laws at the Circle in conjunction with the state. So we already have a reciprocal agreement with state police. But that is our area of patrol. It is part of the city proper. So we patrol there, and the state also patrols there. However, my concern was that there be regularly scheduled walkthroughs by personnel inside the liquor store of the interior of the bathroom just to make sure everything's okay in there. Our police officers would not be doing that, but it was my understanding that the personnel in the store would be doing that.
Would that be something state police would be doing?
Oh, no.
No, not in the
least? Not particularly, not really. I mean, I can envision state troopers or even the police department stopping there to use the facilities if it's convenient.
Certainly.
But I certainly don't envision our officers doing regular walkthroughs unless we develop a problem. But it was my understanding the employees would be doing that and monitoring the interior.
Okay. And you're not expecting any stepped-up patrols by state police now that this is a public facility. My only concern being that there are people that could use it not only that go to the liquor store, but just knowing that it's a convenient public restroom, the locals or homeless people would be able to use that and access it relatively simply by going there. Are there any plans for stepped-up patrols at all?
I can tell you that once this is in place, I will be telling through roll call, I will be telling our troops to keep an eye on this because we have similar concerns.
I mean, in the coordination with the state police, do you know if the state police, because we don't have a representative, I hate to put you on the spot.
No problem.
But do you know if the state police are doing the same coordination with you with stepped-up patrols?
I don't, but I can assure you that I will be in communication with Lieutenant Bobby Quinn, who is the division commander for Troop A, and we'll be putting something in place to keep an eye on that because I'm sure he has a similar concern. Mm-hmm. So that will be done.
Certainly. Thank you, Len.
Sure. Len, while you're there,
yes, sir.
I see on the drawing it calls for 4 exterior wall packs. Do you know what was originally proposed? Was it less than 4, and is 4 2 more than what was originally there?
I don't know. I don't have that.
I think if they're showing the wall packs, I think they might be new, at least some of them. Mm. I would look for confirmation.
Okay.
In spite of what your architect indicated, I think we did have agreement on it.
Okay.
Len, before you step down, did you have any other comments, questions, or concerns at the?
I think, Len, wasn't it the police department that was pushing to have the hours of operation put on this?
The hours of operation for the bathroom should reflect the hours of operation for the store. So the bathroom is not open beyond those hours. And I'm also looking, we wanted, excuse me, we wanted a written MOU with the architect and the planners to all the stipulations, just so that there's no misunderstanding.
Would it be acceptable, this may be for the benefit of the board, would it be acceptable to you if the planning board were to favorably act on this, that we develop that memo jointly with the state? I assume Mr. Hill would agree with that as a work that's still in progress.
That's what I would want. I mean, I would want something in writing agreeing to these stipulations. So
rather
that,
than tabling this, for example, until
right.
they get the memo.
Right.
Would Mr. Hill agree that we can, Mr. Graham, would you agree that you would work with the police department and the planning department to get that memorandum of agreement?
Yeah, I could ask I'd have to defer to the Liquor Commission. For that,
well, would somebody agree that we could work on this because it's been outstanding for a fair yeah. piece?
Yeah, I just want to talk about the lighting. We did agree to have exterior lighting. But not extra pole
right.
lighting.
I would agree with that.
Thank
so
you.
The site plan does show it now.
Right.
Yes. And that happens to be in his letter to you, which I have in front of me, where there is that agreement.
Thank you.
Okay. Any questions?
Good evening. My name is Peter Engel. I'm the Director of Store Operations for the State Liquor Commission. And absolutely, we will put we will memorialize all this in writing to you. The public restrooms are only geared to be open in parallel to the store hours of operation. Absolutely. Again, we're not in the Welcome Center restroom business. We just want to be there to service our customers. So absolutely.
I have a feeling we have too many hands in this. If we can deal with the Liquor Commission directly with the city and the police department, we can get this
absolutely.
Cleared up.
Absolutely. We're more than willing to do whatever it needs to get this project going.
Thank you.
And just for the record, we do have public restrooms there now. They're shared with the store employees, and that is not a very healthy situation we have going on. So we do have them now.
And those restrooms are internal to the building, correct?
No, they're entered from the external, for the customer flow, it's from the outside of the building.
Okay. Good, thank you. Mr. Hoffley.
Just, Mr. Chairman, just for the board, on sheet L1, it does look like notes 1 through 5 were added. Most of those notes seem to be geared towards some of the conditions on the memorandum. Not all of them. I think all of them do. Notes 1 through 5 on L1.
Thank you for pointing that out, Rick. Any other questions by the board? Any other questions? No? Thank you.
Yeah, could I make a comment? Peter mentioned that we had public restrooms there. It's in the back of the store. You know, it's a much worse situation than what we're repairing at this point. And it's been like that for 3 years. And
okay.
So,
thank you.
And I'd also add that the departments have worked closely with the city to come up with a design that the city can support. The original design was something totally different. This is by far better, and we've been working, I think, rather well together, but the devil's been in the details, and I think this will probably address that, and I'm sure Deputy Chief Linda Sessa will lend his hands, to it.
So, thank you.
Yep.
Anybody in the public wish to speak to, for, or against the application? Anybody in the public, to, for, or against? Third time, seeing no one rise. I'll now close the public hearing.
Mr. Chairman, the department would urge that the board approve this, subject to ironing out those details that are addressed in the original letter of recommendation, shall we say, so that Rick can then issue the building permits for it.
So moves with the following 12th. I'm not sure if it should be sort of a replacement of the 12th stipulation, but of a 13th, that specifically the Liquor Commission be detailed as people to work with.
Yep.
In the state, that we mentioned the Liquor Commission by name.
A motion?
Yeah, just as a comment, I mean, many of these items have been addressed on the plans that are before us.
Mm-hmm. So,
I mean, the lighting is on the plan, the hours of operation are on the plan, the responsibility to maintain the building is on the plan, the water shutoff, 5 feet, is on the plan.
Mm-hmm.
The note about water going through the meter is on the plan, so.
I think they've all, they're there.
Contrary to that, they didn't know that.
Right.
They are. Right.
Most of the stuff is covered.
Right.
Is there a second?
Is there a second?
Sure, second.
Second. Any comment on the motion? I just want a point of clarification, if I could, for the department. Item one, that a fence be added to the site plans?
Evidently, the fence is there. There was a sidewalk. I thought that they wanted the fence to be higher, but Deputy Chief DeSessa has definitely clarified that he's satisfied with the fence as long as it's continuous and as long as the vegetation is removed, and I've heard that they're going to do both.
So could we eliminate perhaps that from, if that's
agreeable to the maker of the motion?
Okay.
Second.
Agreeable to the second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on to item B of the public hearings, the application of Stephen J. Brulette, owner, for property located at 398 Cutts Avenue, and Stephen A. Brown, owner, for property located at 450 Cutts Avenue, wherein preliminary and final subdivision approval for lot line revision is requested between two lots having the following. Lot 8, as shown on Assessor Plan 210, increasing in area from 18,690 to 20,278 square feet, and with 127.71 feet of continuous street frontage on Cutts Ave, and Lot 9, as shown on Assessor Plan 210, decreasing in size from 19,050 square feet to 17,462 square feet, and with 110 feet of continuous street frontage on Cutts Avenue. Said lots lie in a district where a minimum lot area of 15,000 square feet and 100 feet of continuous street frontage is required. Said properties are shown on Assessor Plan 210 as lots 8 and 9 and lie within a single residence B district. Who's here tonight on behalf of the applicant?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Bernie Pietlich. I'm here on behalf of Mr. Brulette. This is a relatively simple lot line adjustment where One landowner is buying 10 feet of land from his neighbor so that the entirety of his driveway will now be located on his land, as you can see from the plan. Both lots conform prior to the lot line relocation to all of the zoning requirements. Both lots will continue to conform after the lot line relocation. It's simply shifting the lot line 10 feet in one direction so that the driveway no longer encroaches upon the abutting lot. Relatively simple. Hopefully the board won't have any problems. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them for you.
Any questions for the applicant?
Thank you.
Any questions from the board for the applicant? No? Thank you. I'll open up the public hearing. Anybody in the public wish to speak to, for, against the application? Second time, to, for, against? Third time, seeing no one rise, I'll now close the public hearing.
Mr. Chairman?
It's your pleasure, board. Yes,
Mr. Coker.
Move
to approve as presented.
Second.
Moved and with.
We need to know if you're doing preliminary or final or both.
Oh, let me go back.
I mean, I'd like
preliminary
to
preliminary and final. Yes, with, excuse me, the, with the recommendations from the department of the two stipulations.
Okay. It's been moved. Motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion on the motion for preliminary and final? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you. Moving on to item C, the application of March 22 LLC owner for property located at 58 State Street and Barbara Theodore owner for property located at 449 Court Street, wherein site review approval is requested to construct a 3,210-square-foot mixed-use building on Lot 12 with an access and utility easement extending across Lot 6 with related paving, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said properties are shown on Assessor Plan 105 as Lots 6 and 12 and lie within the Central Business B District and Historic District A. Who's here tonight on behalf of the applicant?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. John Shagnon from Ambit Engineering. Representing the applicant also here tonight is Jennifer Ramsey from Soma Architects, Paul McEachran from the McEachran Law Firm, and Steve Kelm of Old Port Development and March 22 LLC. The project has gone through the requisite HDC approvals and technical review committee approvals. Basically, we're working on a proposed infill to State Street. You might remember this exhibit from when the project was before you for a lot line change, which was approved by the board a couple of months ago. Basically, the this is the existing view from the Memorial Bridge. It shows the former Book Guild structure and a driveway adjacent to it. And then in the proposed view, you see that what we're proposing to do is infill from building to building with a new structure. So we're here for approval of that building tonight. Proposed three-story building, which would infill between 46 State Street and 68 State Street. There'd be some utility connections out on State Street. As mentioned, there is an access and utility easement from Court Street. And if you look at the sheet C3, there's a plan showing parking. This parking is in the rear of the first floor, so you access it from Court Street, and it provides covered parking for the structure. That access is through an easement, which has already been recorded and is available for use by the project. There's some additional work that will be done in Court Street to provide for drainage for the project. As you may be aware, Court Street is being reconstructed and drainage and sewer being separated and utilities being added. However, the last catch basin in the city project is a little further to the west. We're proposing to, at our expense, bring that line a little further up so we can provide a tie-in for site drainage. The Technical Review Committee addressed some comments, which we've addressed in a memo to the board. And I guess at this point, if you have any particular questions about any of the stipulations, we'd be glad to answer those questions. We're asking for approval tonight, and the board, the staff has recommended one additional stipulation that you might consider. We would like to discuss that and hope that you would consider not finding that or making that a stipulation. That was a recommendation that we install a grease trap. There is no proposal for a restaurant at this site, and at some time in the future, if somebody decided they wanted to do that, then they would have to go through the approval process required to convert the use. And so putting it in now doesn't make sense if it's not going to get used. I guess I'll answer any questions you might have.
Any questions for the applicant?
Yes. I just noticed one minor issue that I think may not have been addressed, which was I was wondering about snow in the back there on the brick kind of driveway area. I would assume it's a pretty tight area, so that would be an issue. How you were going to get it out of there or whatever.
Yeah. I think we have some notes about removing snow from the back area.
Oh, okay.
Or we'll put in a heated driveway. Okay. Actually, that's.
Thanks.
Any other questions for the applicant? Yes, Ms.
What was
the
resolution of the chimney issue, the chimney discussion, the height of the chimney?
Yeah, the stipulation, there was a stipulation regarding the chimney. And in discussing the codes with the building department, the chimney is going to have to be raised slightly. I can get Jennifer Ramsey if you need some exact dimensions, but it's a very small increase, and we are going to file an application with the HDC to take care of that. It would be a revision to an existing approval. I have a letter from Roger Klum that I'll hand out in regards to that issue.
We have that.
Yes. John, if you could also comment on Peter Rice. Apparently there was an issue with an escrow account to cover the costs incurred to provide drainage.
Sure. At the project is going to involve working on the, as I mentioned, the drainage extension in Court Street. The project that has been recently kicked off for the Court Street improvements is funded by the city, and basically what we need is the mechanism to include this work, the extension of the drainage in the city street, include that in the contractor's scope of work, so that there would need to be, through the city's engineering firm, additional modifications to the drawings. That would be included and bid by the contractor to be included with the work, and then we would reimburse or pay for that section of it. So the mechanics of the working that out need to be addressed. And we were supposed to meet with the Mr. Rice, or we tried to meet with him when the kickoff meeting for the Court Street project was, which was August 3rd. However, that didn't provide, that wasn't an opportune time. So I have another meeting set up for the 29th to nail that down.
And so if it gets there, we could just make that a condition of approval?
Yes.
Okay.
We're in agreement that we'll pay our, we'll pay for that portion of the extension.
Okay.
So it's just mechanics.
Any other questions for the applicant? Mr. Hopley.
John, I noticed on most of the plan views, you're talking about a new proposed three-story building. And I noticed on the very lead sheet, the sort of rendition shows a four-story building. Any idea which it is?
Yeah, I think the plan should say three full stories, and it should say four-story. I think our plan view is inaccurate in that regard.
Ordinarily, I wouldn't be commenting on anything internal to the building, but of course you've submitted some base internal plans because of the inside parking. Mm-hmm. I guess, and not to be affected by this board's decision, I guess anytime I see a four-story building with one stair, and when the one stair is internal to the building and doesn't discharge directly outside, I get concerned. It may affect some of your parking design as we go forward. So it's not a code review. I can't do a code review, but right away that's a red flag. And I only mention it because you've got five spaces down there that might be affected, might not. But it's a huge red flag to me as I look at this with one stair, four stories, and the one stair is inside the building. It doesn't go directly outside and passes by the elevator shaft. So we'll deal with that in life after zoning.
I'm glad you brought that up, Mallow. Thank you.
Just beware.
Thank you.
Any other questions for the applicant? No? Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll open up the public hearing. Anybody in the public wish to speak to, for, or against the application? Second time, anybody to, for, or against?
Mr. Chairman, before you close, on the issue of the grease trap, there may be a way to deal with that, but the department did communicate with Dave Allen, deputy director, and he's very concerned that there is not a grease trap. We're going to be looking at adding a grease trap to another building tonight as a plan amendment down on Fleet Street. And we did have to add one also to the former Eagle building because the first tenant in there was a restaurant. The other way to do this may be that the applicant meet with DPW to identify a site that would be satisfactory for a grease trap so that we know there won't be a request for a waiver. But I would defer to Dave Allen and Peter Rice as to whether or not that's acceptable, but that might be one way around that.
To just locate a potential.
The biggest problem is if the lot is overbuilt, so you can't put in the grease trap. So let's at least make sure there's a site, and if DPW is acceptable with that, I think that would probably address it. And perhaps the applicant would indicate that that's all right.
Rick.
Well, and I think, Dave, what you're saying is we consummate that on a plan, and the note through via showing where it would be and some notation that this would be the location should the need arise.
Correct.
For this device. And so it's all agreed upon that that's where it'll be if it's needed. If it's not needed, mm-hmm. That won't be there.
Every time we've been told they're not needed, they're needed, and they have to go in.
I'd like to just close the public hearing if I could, and then we can discuss it. Is that all right, Dave?
Sure.
Third time, anybody too far against? Seeing no one rise, I'll close the public hearing.
Wait.
Up.
Paul?
Nope. Mr. Coker.
I'm representing.
Hold on just a minute. Mr. Coker.
Well, can we determine whether the public hearing is closed?
One more,
It appeared to me that Attorney McEachran was working his way up to the...
If there's a motion, we can have limited discussion on that motion if we need to. Okay? So let's get the board's discussion. If we need to call the applicant back up, we can do so.
Okay. Thank you.
All right.
The applicant had asked to not have this done with the grease trap.
Correct.
I guess I'm just trying to weigh what's the harm in doing it, what's the harm in not doing it. It seems to me that if somebody has to come for a grease trap and there isn't a place to put it, then it would seem reasonable to say then maybe that's not the place for whatever is causing you to need the grease trap.
Right.
That oftentimes doesn't work, though. What's happening is the city is under rather strict, I wish somebody from DPW was here to address it, but the city is under very strict regulations now in terms of the handling of this material. The only way you can get around it is if a waiver is granted. And waivers are sometimes granted for old buildings that are being retrofitted.
I don't recall ever granting a waiver. That's not something
it's
we
not
do.
It's not something
is
you do.
Oh, all right. That's
the issue here is a new building being constructed in a central business district that encourages mixed uses should be provided, or I'm suggesting identify an area where a grease trap can go, so that by approving a building, you don't create a hardship that later comes back to haunt you when a waiver is requested. You'll recall on 99 or Martingale, for example, there was a great deal of discussion on where the grease trap would be located. In terms of the Eagle Photo building, a grease trap was finally located, I believe, in the parking garage area. On one that we're going to see tonight on Fleet Street, you're going to be approving a location that's outside so that it can be handled. I'm rather confident there's probably an area on that lot that can be identified so that we can know now whether or not this building as designed would require a waiver. Because if it did, then I think DPW would not be supporting this particular project.
Okay,
but isn't, if there is not, if we don't put this on the plan now, the onus is on the applicant to meet, the future applicant, to meet whatever standards are supposed to be met. In essence, that's not our problem.
It is.
Right.
Okay, but I'm asking the question to get educated on it.
Let Rick comment on that.
In the future, it's an existing building, and they quote, and they cry, oh, woe is us, it's an existing building. Mm-hmm. This has cut us a break. So the time to get it is in new buildings. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And when you can do it, you know, new buildings, you can comply with the code. There's no gimmies and alternatives and okay. trade-offs and all that stuff. So there shouldn't be. So, but the hard part comes on enforcement down the road when folks cry, you know, woe is me and expense. It's always the expense.
Also, I'd point out this issue was raised. You can find it in the minutes, but it didn't get addressed. That's why I bring it up. It's in the minutes that the grease trap is a problem. It's identified, I believe, by Dave Allen. And this is the time to get that clarified one way or the other. I think a suitable solution, though, is to identify the area that's acceptable to DPW and that allows it to keep moving.
And additionally, what brings this to light is that on two brand new buildings in the downtown that were approved without these devices, as Dave said, the first request in is a restaurant. Oh, we're never going to have one. Well, guess what? We're just trying to close that gap.
Trying to understand
upfront
the problem.
So,
though, if a restaurant is there, why is it a difficulty to put it there? I mean, other than the expense and that waiver. I mean, who grants the waiver?
Department of Public Works.
You set up an immediate conflict. The zoning ordinance allows the use. So then it immediately sets up a hardship where none really truly exists.
It's all about cost because this is a septic tank. Envision a septic tank outside the building.
Right.
So you're talking earth excavation, and then you have to tie this into the city system. So you're dealing with grades between where that tank is and what elevation it is, the invert out, what the grades are in the street that's associated with this, how you get the effluent from the tank to the street. It's
a nightmare.
It's so much easier to do it.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. And so,
right, Mr.
But
Will.
Then it's still an expense.
I'm generally confident in the department to
to warn us ahead of time that these are problems. But I think as a board, perhaps we might review this, and as we're reviewing the site review regulations, to just say, look, you may not have a grease trap, but you better have this, and just as right down the line, oh, I'm not going to have a grease trap.
Make it a procedure.
Yeah, fair enough. You don't have a grease trap, but if you do, you better do.
No, I think that all new buildings, you know, potential grease trap location is noted or something.
Yeah. I think that would be a good uniform policy to have, that even if they come before us and say, we don't, we're not going to have a grease trap, we have something to respond to that.
Correct.
Well, I agree. I think what's proposed is a good solution. It just seems to me, in fairness, our practice is going forward, and it may not only be downtown buildings, then, is what I hear you saying. It may be
general business.
Well, it feels like we need to give some thought to it before that we seem to be doing it arbitrarily just because it's mixed use or it's downtown. I think we need to be clear about the when it applies and when it doesn't apply. And is this the first time this board is making this?
It's become more common with the federal regulations, but we've been running into it consistently in the downtown. One reason is a central business district lot is so small.
Right.
And 5% open space requirement is so minimal that it's the space. So you generally don't run into it in other districts.
But is this the first time this board is suggesting, when people are saying there will not be a restaurant, that is suggesting that we need it on the plan regardless?
In the other two instances, one was forced by DPW, and in the other it was actually the use that was coming in right off the block required a grease trap, and we indicated that, or DPW indicated, no waivers would be granted. And it forced but there was a redesign to get one in.
Okay.
And all we're suggesting right now is, if DPW will concur, is identify where it's going to go now so that we know the site will take it. I would submit when in the future it will be required.
John, quickly.
There's another way to think about this, though. On sheet C2, note 7, it says no restaurant use is proposed for the new building. Any change of use would require compliance with city ordinances, including the installation of a grease trap for any restaurant, food preparation, takeout uses. Now, this note is similar to ones that were on the other plans, and a restaurant did come in those two cases, but also places were found to put the grease traps on those two. One was during construction, and the other one is pre-construction. But
I understand the note.
The note says, or you could strengthen the note by a stipulation that says there will not be a restaurant use unless it complies with the city codes. And then that would allow for changes in codes, too, which may occur.
Doesn't leave the problem of, at some point down the road, I mean, I don't see an issue with just finding a location on a drawing. That's all that we're asking, is something dashed, shown on a drawing.
But it's a pretty much a hypothetical. You're asking to take, now these are downtown CBB lots, so as David mentioned, 5% open space. There's not the sewer connection right now goes out the front of the building towards State Street. So you're asking us to put something on the plan that would conceivably be an impediment to other uses of that.
That's what it's intended to do. If you need the grease trap, that's how you get into a waiver request, which is what we're trying to avoid.
But what I'm saying is, if you say that they won't get a restaurant use unless they comply with the code, then if there was, if they can do it, then they can have a restaurant. If they can't do it, they can't have a restaurant.
That's going to set up a conflict, though, with the zoning ordinance. This is going to be on a site plan that probably no one's going to look at. It's going to depend on this board, the department, to remember well into the future, by the way, there's a note there. That isn't the way you generally would do this. I think this plan is ready to be done, but I think probably the applicant and the city and DPW need to figure out how they're going to handle this. And perhaps my suggestion to the board might be is that you approve this with the stipulation that we work this out and report back to you if we can't.
because I don't even know if DPW will accept an identified location.
That's true.
But we're not proposing the use, so...
You're not.
You can't deny the... We're proposing a different use. I mean, we're within the zoning ordinance on this particular use.
But not within site review.
But, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Cole.
May I ask a question of the applicant?
Absolutely.
John, I guess I'm trying to understand what specifically is your objection to having this. A restaurant is a permitted use in this district, okay? Statement of fact. The fact that you may today, in all your heart of hearts, say there will be no restaurant there. Down the road, things change. What specifically is your objection to just locating one, not putting one in, not in, just locating it?
You want to take that one on?
Okay. I think I can help answer that question. My name is Paul McEachran, representing the applicant. It's intended that the building will be a condominium use dedicated to condominium with residences above. And in the description of the condominium, it will say that no restaurant use will be allowed. And when the people buy the units above for residential, they'll be able to rely on that. In order to put a restaurant in, you not only need a grease trap, you need sophisticated ventilation. And you don't put a restaurant under expensive condominiums without adequate ventilation, and there's no provision for that. So, you know, if you want to design it for the best convenience of the city, you would have to say we've got to put in a ventilation system as well, because that might occur if a restaurant goes in. But we're telling you and representing to you, and the notes of the plan say that, that no restaurant uses will be there, and the condominium documents will be recorded. And in order to amend those, you need two-thirds of the unit owners, and they're going to be residences above. So that as a practical matter, it's not going to happen. It may well be that this site doesn't allow, in fact, a 1,000-gallon septic tank. I mean, it's the 5% open space may not be with, you know, it just may not be possible. And we're giving you every assurance, and you're saying, well, we're going to forget in the future. Well, not if someone comes in and wants a waiver. You're going to look at the record, and this will be in this building file.
Well, I don't believe that this board is asking you to put in a grease trap, nor are we asking you to put in exhaust systems and ventilation systems. I believe what the board is asking is to merely locate one.
And we're certainly willing to do that if that is possible. But if it isn't possible, why should the application be turned down if it's not possible? We're willing to sit down with Public Works and see.
If I can stop you right there, why don't we just make it a condition of approval that the applicant work with city staff and DPW to find a suitable location, and the department can report back to the board, period.
If the site doesn't sustain a grease trap, the approval is granted subject to trying to work it out.
Yeah.
And we assure you, we will.
Correct.
If the site sustains a place for that grease trap,
we will defer to DPW.
We'll put it on. That's a no-brainer.
That
and we don't
that
object
question.
To that.
Okay, thank you.
You sort of stole my
question. Doesn't, then
question.
We'll be back here anyway.
And Dave just stole the rest of it.
Well, that's the question I have, is we'll be back. You mean 10 years from now or before the building permit?
Next month. The purpose is to get this addressed to everyone's satisfaction.
So hypothetically, Paul.
Yeah.
When we have the meeting, if there isn't, we're going to report back here and we'll have to do something else. If there is, it does take care of it.
But we've been before the city boards for a long time, and the applicant is anxious to...
It's a complicated project with a lot of conditions in a very tight area, and we appreciate all the effort that the applicant and everyone has put into it, and we're going to try to get this wrapped up.
Why don't we leave it that we'll you'll work with staff and DPW on...
Let me ask you.
All right. Before we give up, hear from John.
Just the understanding of the proposed stipulation. It talks about, it uses the word site, and this is the property line in the back, and it's not, there isn't enough room without changing the configuration of the building to put a grease trap in on the site. This is an area that is an access and utility easement. There is going to be sewer in Court Street. So we would show a pipe, a grease trap under the driveway, and a connection to the sewer in Court Street. If that handles it, that's what we'll show on the plan.
And it'll be up to DPW to indicate that they concur in that. It seems like a reasonable suggestion to explore.
Okay. And the reason we hesitate, though, is... we shouldn't have to, because we're not proposing a restaurant, but if that's what it takes, that's what we'll do, and I'm sure it will meet all the codes and be acceptable to DPW.
Correct. Thank you.
Never mind.
With that being said,
it's settled.
Minimal discussion after a public hearing, so before we do the only other, well, let's do I hear a motion?
Move approval with the 25 stipulations as well as the agreed upon stipulation provided in the update about grease trap, and having a conversation with the Department of Public Works and the Planning Department, and having something on the plan, and if it doesn't work out with the Department of Public Works, it'll be brought back to the board.
And could we also include a stipulation that an escrow account to cover the costs incurred to provide drainage to the site?
I like that idea, yes. That's agreeable to the maker of the motion.
Thank you.
I'd also indicate that most of the conditions, it isn't worth going through them, have been satisfied.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So it's really checking them off on the finished plan.
There's a motion for approval. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Thank you, John. Moving on to the last public hearing of the night, item D, the application of Micronics Realty Trust owner for property located at 200 West Road, wherein site review approval is requested to construct a 75-foot by 94-foot one-story addition with access drive and additional parking, with related paving, utilities, landscaping, drainage, and associated site improvements. Said properties are shown on Assessor Plan 267 as Lot 22. And lies within an industrial district. Who's here tonight on behalf of the applicant?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Peter Weeks, and I'm here this evening along with Dennis Moulton of Ames MSC for approval of the addition as you specified in your notice. Just to give you a little bit of background, this board last month approved the conditional use permit that was recommended by the Conservation Commission unanimously. And it is in the process now of getting the DES approval, which I believe should be here any day. And that was one of the stipulations that the TAC had made, that the approval would be subject to the satisfactory issuance of the DES approval. This is an industrial building located on West Road. It was done back, the building was done back by Trapper Brown in the early 1990s. Our client purchased it in 1992, and at the last meeting I gave you a kind of a history of the company, of what they do and why they need this addition. A couple of things that were proposed at the Conservation Commission were to improve the drainage on the site, and that was part of the conditional use approval. We also, Dennis Moulton will provide you tonight with some of the landscaping details of the rain garden that was proposed by the Conservation Commission, which the applicant was willing to do. The driveway access, which is being proposed, is again something that was recommended by the Conservation Commission and the applicant has agreed to, and that is a different type of treatment of the driveway, so it will not be asphalt, but it will be something that will be able to be drained and still be able to be used as a loading or delivery area for trucks. And I think we submitted that at the time of the conditional use permit, so you have that information. This evening we're asking for final site review approval, and we would concur with the minutes of the TAC meeting to include the stipulations that came both from the Conservation Commission and the conditional use permit application and to be included as part of the approval, the site review approval, making those stipulations part of this approval as well. At this point, I'll turn it over to Dennis Moulton, who will answer any of the technical questions you may have. I think that this is a good addition to the industrial area of the city, and this addition will allow the Micronix to remain as a Portsmouth-based industrial user rather than having to go to another town. They need this expansion to be able to continue their operation that is growing. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Dennis Moulton with Ames MSC. Peter went over the basics of the application. If you remember from our previous presentation to the board, this is an approximately 2-acre site located behind an existing building on West Road. The existing building is approximately 19,400 square feet with parking. Proposal is for approximately 7,000 square foot addition. We are providing 43 parking spaces on site to the side and along the side of the building here. 40 are required according to the building size. As Peter mentioned, we're as part of the 7,000 foot addition, we are constructing an access to the loading dock area. This access will be constructed of a grasscrete product, which we presented information to you on at the conditional use application and approval. The stormwater management system is, as we had also presented at the previous hearing, it is basically will take the sheet flow from the existing pavement, collect it in a stone-filled trench, and then allow the water that collects there to flow over this vegetated filter strip with plantings that were specified by New Hampshire Soils, and they went into great details at the previous hearing as to the specific plants that they would be using there, which were wetland friendly and tolerant, and they felt that they enhanced the treatment of that stormwater. As Peter mentioned, I do have a detail prepared by New Hampshire Soils of the rain garden plantings. I'd like to hand that out at this time. Again, these details were developed by New Hampshire Soils in accordance with information that we've gathered on rain gardens. And the basic premise of the rain garden is it's sort of a shallow pool area that will be used to collect the roof runoff or part of the roof runoff and provide treatment to that that stormwater. In the event of larger volume storms, the rain garden will naturally flow over the side and into the trench, and the water will, you know, just flow into the trench and out through the vegetated filter strip. The proposal for the rain garden will be in this corner area, and we will direct the roof runoff from the new addition to that area, at least half of it. The other half will be
directed to the rear of the building and out towards the wetland. If you have any questions at this point, I'd be happy to answer them. Or if you'd like me to go through the stipulations of the TAC, I could do that.
No, I don't need to see them. Any questions for the applicant? No. Mr. Hopley.
Just a one. What's a phragmite?
Phragmites is a invasive species that has permeated wetlands throughout New England and probably throughout the United States. It's a non-native plant. There is a native plant? Yeah, it's a non-native plant, but it's there isn't, I guess, a native Phragmites that is desirable, but it's not very common. There is a this is, I guess, an Australian Phragmites, from what I understand. It's considered invasive, and it's something that we should try to, you know, remove. And that is part of the stormwater management plan. We are including regular checks of the wetland area and removal of Phragmites.
Thanks.
I have a couple questions, Dennis. Talk to me about winter maintenance when we've got our historic winters and we have a couple inches of ice on this grasscrete. Mm-hmm. How's that maintained with a grass base and ice on top of it?
The maintenance of that during the winter would have to be a non-salt treatment. It would probably have to be plowed not down to the actual base material, but within an inch or so, then probably sanded for traction. But that's probably the best you could do there.
And what's the likelihood that somebody's going to plow it down within a couple inches and not have this? My guess is, and it's just a guess, and I'm being pessimistic, that in X amount of years from now, that'll probably be paved. That's my concern, is that, you know, you're specking grasscrete. Is there any long-term history or in the New England area with grasscrete?
Long-term history? I'm not aware of it. It's a fairly new product for us to use. It is something that's been used in other parts of the country. We have specced it on other projects in New England, and I don't think that I don't think those projects have been built at this time.
Why a grasscrete as opposed to just possibly a gravel that you can maintain? Where this grasscrete, my guess is, there's no maintenance on it.
Well, the grasscrete is actually a more permeable material. Through testing that they've done, the grasscrete is actually as permeable, if not more permeable, than the native soils that it replaces.
I don't doubt the permeability. I'm just saying, for what little area you have,
right.
It seems to me that in X amount of years, that's going to be black.
That may or may not be true. I can't argue with you, but. I mean, that would seem to be an enforcement problem.
I guess I'm bringing it up to make it on the record that should this become a maintenance issue, it needs to be maintained, not just torn out and gravel and paved. So,
okay. I understand your concern.
Thank you. The other, just a question, I guess, is the little triangles in the middle. I know it's a vegetated filter strip, but what is that, and could that possibly be put on a legend somewhere?
The triangles, it's just a hatching.
Right, but what is a vegetated filter strip? What's that going to be?
A vegetated filter strip is just an area where we're going to be planting a mixture of wetland. It's a wetland seeding mix, an erosion control mix, which is a mixture of native soils, native plants. But it's also, we had specific plantings that we showed, I believe it's shown down in the lower corner here, which shows the additional plants that we're providing within that. Normally, a vegetated filter strip would just be grassed, but we feel that by providing this wetland mix and the additional plants, that may not show up on your site plan now that I think about it, because this is actually the conditional use plan.
Okay, I guess if it gets that far, I'd like a condition to be that vegetative filter strip, that there's some delineation in the legend that points to that and says see seed mixture on sheet whatever. But right now I have no inkling as to what that is.
I apologize if that didn't, I guess I did not show
up. No, I'm trying to do, Dennis, is that two or three years down the road that we've got something that we can go back on and say that grasscrete needs to be maintained, not paved over. Yeah. That's just my concern. Okay. So, any other questions for the applicant? No? Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'll open up the public hearing. Anybody in the public wish to speak to, for, or against the application? Second time, anybody to, for, or against? Third time, seeing no one rise, I'll now close the public hearing. What's your pleasure, Board?
Chairman, I move for approval of site review for this application and with the associated 12 stipulations, I believe. Mm-hmm. Yes.
You are correct.
Second.
I'd just like to, for the record, if it's acceptable to the maker of the motion, just put that the note for the hatching be shown on there. Mm-hmm. and designate. And if we could just put a note that any change in the approved site plan shall be first presented to the city for a review or approval or something that ties. I got to say, I absolutely commend you for the steps you've taken with the rain garden, the grasscrete. I think it's great. I think maintenance is the biggest problem that we see. You can spec a swirl separator, but the maintenance comes down to city officials having to go out and police these. So I'd also like to see that note put on the drawing that any changes made come before the city for review and approval.
That's agreeable to the second.
Agreeable to. So,
any other comments? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? And the chair votes aye. Moving on to item three, city council referral and requests. The request to purchase the unnamed lane abutting Pleasant Street. I think this is the first time we've seen this, David.
This month.
The great legal team of Mr. Thorson and the city continue to endeavor to find the long-lost deeds to this property. We think we may be close to a report, but we would beg you to put it up until September.
So you're so seeking moved. A motion to table?
So moved.
Something unique.
So we need to vote on that.
Yeah, just move it to September meeting if it's understood.
So moved.
Table to next month. Moved and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
And if there are anybody out there, if they find an artifact.
Well, the interesting thing is it's helpful to actually do this research, but it's proving to be a little more, well, it was problematic the last time, and it continues to be.
So moving on to item four, amended site plan review. Item A, property located at 154, 158 Fleet Street, the addition of a grease trap.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, we've asked John Shagnon to be available in case there were board questions to it, because there have been some concerns with it. But they prepared a plan that was reviewed by DPW in terms of identifying a site. This one will be installed. DPW has indicated they are satisfied with it. We indicated that we would bring it to you as a recommended amendment to the site plan short of a public hearing. But we asked John to be here in case there were any questions or concerns with it. But we would recommend that you approve this as a minor amendment to the site plan.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Item B, property located at 225 Heritage Avenue, Smutty Nose Brewing Company. Revised grading.
This one I will need some help from John on, but largely in the process of building the addition on the Smutty Nose Brewing Company, it became apparent that a revision in the grading plan would work to everyone's benefit. David DeFosis has reviewed it and favorably recommends it, but he also added that he doubted that I understood it. So I thought perhaps John might want to explain the rationale for it, but again, it's a minor amendment, but we thought the board should understand what the changes were.
Mr. Chair, for the record, due to a minor conflict, I'm going to have to recuse myself from this application, even though it's an amended site plan.
Okay, thank you. Yes, John.
Yes, basically the amendment is what we have is a request by the landlord. We did the site plan for the tenant, and in reworking the paving to the west or the left side, the rear of the building, we had made some changes to the grading, and unbeknownst to the landlord, those changes resulted in the dock the loading docks being less than 48 inches. The landlord then got in touch with us and stated their desire to keep that at exactly 48 inches for any future tenants that may want to use those loading docks. So a minor regrading was undertaken. And another thing that came up is apparently the pavement, part of the pavement was covered with some dirt, which wasn't really readily seen when we did the survey in January because it was all frozen, so it was as hard as the pavement. So basically there was available to us an ability to lower that and keep the dock, the 48-inch dock high grades. So that was the revision in a nutshell.
I think the key was that there would be no negative impact on the abutting properties, and that's what was determined, correct?
Exactly. The paving flows the same way as it did in the other version. It's just slightly lower.
Okay. Thank you, John.
Okay, thank you.
We would ask that you approve this also as a minor amendment now that you have the explanation.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye.
Abstain.
Mr. Willis abstained. Item 5, new business. David, you want to talk about that?
Actually, Peter Britz is here because he's been masterminding the effort in this regard, and I think he can provide the board with an update. He brings his chorus with him.
Just as a little background that, as you know, 3 years ago we completed the wetland inventory of the city, and part of that wetland inventory they looked at prime wetlands in the city and made some preliminary recommendations. We've gone ahead and hired Mark West as part of a grant program to take a look at those recommendations that were made to look at a prime wetland inventory for the city. So they basically took the inventory that Jim Gove did, refined it. He's still in the process of refining it. He's going to present at the September Conservation Commission meeting his findings and what that amounts to, what the process is. It's a statewide prime wetland designation, if we choose to go that route, where we look at wetlands that have a higher value, and the effect is that if a certain wetland is designated as a prime wetland, then there'll be a greater setback to that wetland from the state's, well, not a greater setback, but a closer scrutiny when a project comes up. So a project that's adjacent to a prime wetland may not have any impact on that wetland, but will still require a public review at the state level. So it doesn't do a lot in terms of the city ordinance, although we could, with our zoning update, increase our setbacks around those wetlands. We have that choice, and it'll give us an area of where the prime wetlands are. So with that background, that's what the prime wetland process is. What we're doing is bringing a first look at the prime wetlands to the Conservation Commission, and to save money from the consultant standpoint, I'd like to see if we could get both boards together to do that. And the best time that I've come up with is the next Conservation Commission meeting, September 13th. Now, their meeting is usually at 3:30, and so I wanted to get a sense of whether people wanted to attend that, whether we should try and push that to an evening meeting or have a separate evening meeting with both boards. Just try and get a sense from this board how you want to do that, if people are interested in attending, or you'd rather just let them handle it, and then whether it goes straight to the city council or through this board.
September 13th is a Wednesday?
That's right.
Okay.
Yep. The second Wednesday. That's their meetings.
Would there be a possibility of, is that the HDC?
It'd be the second HDC meeting if they had an overflow. Their first meeting is the first Wednesday.
That was one of the issues we were dealing with. Yeah. This is really the Conservation Commission's meeting, but it's important that the Planning Board take part. Peter's looking for what you would prefer. I know, Paige, there may be some problems there, but we could perhaps explore as to whether or not if we could do it in an evening so more could make it, and if possible to televise it, and if not, perhaps to hold it in one of the alternate meeting rooms.
I think it's going to be a real work session at this point. I don't think it's ready for TV. Okay. But I do think that, well, I mean, it could be, but it's going to be a work session where they take a look at all the wetlands and figure out where to start drawing those boundaries. But the other option would be if you want to go ahead and let them hold the meeting on September 13th at their normal time, whoever can attend, and then I can report back to this board what the findings are. and then take input from that process and possibly have Mark West available then too.
I'd like to see, is it possible maybe to have it to pick some early evening, and if we can make it, great. If not, they can still continue, but I'd like to see if, I know some board members would probably want to go. I personally couldn't do 3:30 on a Wednesday, but if we picked a 6 o'clock.
We could try that same night. How about we just move that same day, but move it to 6 o'clock that evening?
Fine. And those of us that can make it certainly can, but at least we have some representation at that meeting.
Okay.
We could find a conference room if it isn't in here because of the HDC or something.
Yeah, we might have to find a separate location, but yeah.
Great.
Will that meet with the board's approval?
Yep,
absolutely.
What do you think the work session would be, an hour or hour and a half?
Between an hour and a half, probably, yep.
This would be the 13th of September?
That's right.
Correct.
Yep.
Assuming the board could send something out too.
Yeah, we'll once we get confirmation, we'll get it out to you.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll just check with the Conservation Commission, make sure we don't lose all those members, but they should be available because their meetings often go a little
okay.
later.
Okay, so. Thank you, Peter.
Okay.
Do we have any other new business, David?
I've got one to bring up with you, and that is I'm told that the City Council will be holding a work session on affordable housing. I think it's the third Monday.
It's, hang on. I think so, but I'm not, I think we were still taking comment on that in terms of whether that is going to be the topic okay. for that or not. So
okay.
we're still.
There is, why don't we leave it this way? There is going to be a session, and what you're going to be invited to it, and as soon as we have a definite time and a date, we'll get that out to you.
Thank you.
Just so that all those communications are going, and we may actually be doing a brief report on where we stand to it.
Okay. When you say a brief report, you mean similar to the work we've been doing on an ordinance that has gone from an amendment to an existing proposal to an out-and-out ordinance that helps affect affordable housing as a whole.
Not to speak for the council, it'll be what they want, but I think we have something to report.
Yeah.
Is that all you have, David?
Well, the last one is we've got a New Hampshire Supreme Court case that we've provided you, which shows that we the courts may be moving more back to the traditional stance in terms of variances. And it's just interesting for the board as we go through the zoning ordinance with Mr. Tainer.
Right. Is that it, David? So, motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Good night. Thank you.